Hello, everyone. My name is Monroe Mann, and we have a BreakDiving book club happening right now. Remember our motto, no rules, no excuses, no regrets. If you want to join us, come to breakdiving.io. You can be a part of these events and be part of our awesome worldwide community. I'm joined today by Malak Masaba in, are you in Saudi or in Jordan? In Saudi Arabia at the moment. And Hichandra, who is in India. And we were just talking about the fact that I used to, right down here, have about 30 books. And my friend Linda came over and goes, why do you have
books all at once?
Yeah, she said, why do you have all these books here? He goes, you're not reading all them. I said, yeah, I am. And she goes, what do you mean? Tell me how you're reading 30 books. I said, I have a circuit. And so they all go, I'll sit down for about an hour and I'll pick five and I'll read about 10 minutes in each book. And then I'll move it from one pile to another pile. And the books just go back and forth from pile A to pile B, back and forth.
You know why you do that? I think I know why you do that. Because most of the books that you read are like self-development kind of books. Like you don't read anything that's like story related, you know, like you don't read science fiction or anything like that.
I have books like that. And if it's a book like that, I'll keep it by my bed and I'll read it a little bit every night type of thing. But yeah, most of the books are business books or finance books. But even that, people say, well, why don't you just read one till the beginning? Again, to me, I think it's the same thing, I think, with everything in my life. How many businesses do I run? Six, seven? How many books am I reading all at the same time? 30. But anyway, she said, Monroe, you can take the books and put them on the bookshelf. And then when you want, you can go get four and bring them over.
And it actually
worked out really well because the top shelf are the ones that are in progress. I'll read and then I'll put them on the bottom shelf. So it's the same pile A and pile B, but they just shuffle back and forth between the top shelf and the bottom shelf. And then she said, well, what about all these other books? She goes, get them off the floor. And so I had to put them in my closet. There's a closet right behind here. There are books from floor to ceiling.
You're not reading those.
So what's that?
You're not reading those?
No, at the moment, there are books that I have either already read and I'm working on. What I do, every book that I read, like I have Before You Quit Your Job by Robert Kiyosaki here. After I read it, I take all the underlines and I type up a 1 or 2 page summary for every single book that I have. And then I give the book away. I give it to whatever.
How easy is it for you to do that? I find it so hard to do what? To let go of a book, especially if I liked it.
That's the problem I had until I realized I don't really need to reread the book. I've got all the underlines, the things that were important to me. So if I take those underlines and I put them onto a document, it released the psychological possession syndrome that I had.
I don't know. It doesn't work with me, especially with the books that I really, really love. Like if I find this one book that I'm in love with, I just can't get myself to like leave it. Even when I travel, sometimes I just stare at the book and I just want to take it with me. But my parents would be like, my next stop, like we're coming back, you know. But
You know what changed for me is moving from New York down here to Florida.
Yeah, probably.
And realizing how much effort it is to move things, and books are heavy and take up a massive amount of time. And maybe one day I'll be in one place and I can have a library. But I realize, like right now I have stuff in a storage locker in New York, about 20 crates full of more books. And I'm paying money every month to store these books. And then I'm thinking, Monroe, you've got to read them and get rid of them. And I realize by having the notes, by creating the notes, like the 2 or 3 page note documents for each one, I know which books I got rid of. So then it's not a matter of, what was the name of that book? I had it and I gave, no, I've got them all there. And if I really want to, I can go buy it again or go to the library and read it, knowing I've already got a set of notes for it. So it's actually been really, I've given away since I've been here, probably about 20 books that I've read and took notes on.
I really hope I become you. Cause it's hard. Is it me or is he like lagging?
You don't want the full Monroe Man package. Who's lagging?
Oh, you were lagging. I just heard what you said.
Yeah, it says my internet connection is unstable. Oh. You know what? I think it did that as soon as I was talking about you don't want the whole Monroe Man package, because it was basically telling me that I'm unstable.
Yeah, I guess. Oh, no, but that's fine. That's like the fun in all of this. You're lagging again.
Did you hear what I said?
No.
I said, it's the story of my life. I'm lagging again.
Well, at least it was fun. So.
Anyway, but I while I was over there, when I got the books that three of the books that I'm reading now, I grabbed the four books that I'm going to sit and read as soon as we're off here. I'm going to sit down for an hour and I'm going to read four of them from the top shelf, and then boom, they're going on the second shelf.
The same day?
You know actually why I also read them all the time? It takes, these books are so chock full of information. Like here is.
Exactly. That's exactly what I said.
Ray Dalio's Principles. I read 1.5 pages and I think, okay, I just want to think on that.
Books, like their goal is for you to learn something, right? So you like you're reading and one page, you can like have like 10 different new concepts or like information or whatever that may be. And so in order for you to just think about them and then deeply understand them, you need a break. That's exactly what school is all about. And so that's the same thing with these books. But when you're reading like books, like for example, when Heechandra is reading like science fiction books, because it's a story, you get annoyed if you stop reading this for a while and move on to another book, because it's like connecting with you in some way, you know? But that's exactly what I said. So because you're reading more serious stuff, these like books need some type of break and you need to change to feel more motivated, which is not the case when it comes to like storybooks or science fiction or whatever that may be, like novel or whatever.
To add to that, the I often notice somebody will get one book, such as this book, Principles, or the Landlord's Guide to Finding Great Tenants. And it's so dense. Like I just told you, after you read one chapter of the Landlord's Guide to Finding Tenants, I'm exhausted. And so most people only think, oh, I'm exhausted, so I can only read one business book at a time. They're wrong.
Yeah.
You can read many different types of self-help books if the subject matter is completely different.
Exactly.
So like reading this for an hour, exhausting, but you still have energy to read something lighter like The Principles, or even lighter, which is just a history book about India.
1,000%.
So, yeah. Heechandra, what are your thoughts on all this?
I think... if you love reading books, it's all different matter, because I don't think any book, if you love reading books, you just get one book and you finished it up till the end. If you love it and you thought about it almost all week and even months, for me, it even years, actually, it goes like that. In my background, if I read one book, the whole process of what you can say, contemplation on it goes for years, almost 7-8 years, something like that. And I write something after 8 or 10 years, something like that. So this is like me. I can't comprehend reading many books in 1 day or 2 days or something. I never did that, actually. I take one book. Yeah.
I'm sorry, go ahead. You take one book. What?
I take one book. If I love it, means I read one, two, three pages. And if I love it, I just go on up till the end. Okay. And until it finishes, means it takes, if it is 500 pages, 1,000 pages, or 2,000 pages book. Okay. So if it takes 15
You have days, a book, you have some books that have 2,000 pages in them?
I have a book has 10,000 pages.
Oh my God, I was reading a book a few days ago, 1,000 pages, and it was the most amazing book I've ever read. Like my favorite book of all time.
Yeah.
And I read it in like 3 days. I was literally just on my couch reading.
But how can a book have 10,000 pages in one book? I mean, look at this.
Yeah,
this thing's exactly. Very thick, and it's got, this is 650 pages. If it's 10,000 pages, it's going to be this thick.
Yeah, but we divided by volume. It's a one book only. If we divide by 10 volumes, it's going to be 10,000 pages.
Oh, volumes.
Yeah, but it's the same book. Okay. It's only one book that goes on for the 10 volumes.
I part of me thinks it's either these science fiction authors are absolutely incredible, that they can write a 10,000 page book, or they have a big problem with cutting out the garbage.
No.
And they just like to write and be very verbose.
Do you know that J.R.R. Tolkien, the Lord of the Rings? Do you know that?
Lord of the Rings.
The story is based on the J.R.R. Tolkien. Okay, he's the writer of that story. That story goes for almost 15 volumes. Okay, it is almost like 20,000 pages.
20,000?
Yeah, 20,000 pages of the story. It goes for 15 volumes of the story.
There are 15 volumes, but Lord of the Rings, there were just three books that I read.
No, that there are movies actually. That those are the movies that have been transformed from the story. The actual story is almost of 15 volumes.
Original story. Hold on a second. Let's look. I want to look up. Let's go to here, and let's go to Google.com and, or let's see, Amazon. Let's see, smile.amazon, and let's do J.R.R. Tolkien books.
Yeah.
So you're saying there are a lot more. So here's the ones, the four that I'm familiar with. The Hobbit.
These are the stories related to the movies. Okay.
But you're saying that there's other books. Oh, look at this. The Fall of Numenor, The Silmarillion.
Yeah.
What else? Is there other
ones? Yeah, I mean, these are the,
oh, the History of Middle Earth.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh my gosh, this guy was writing like crazy. Tales from the Perilous Realm, Nature of Middle Earth, The Fall of the Gandolfin. Really?
Yeah.
The Children of Húrin.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Beren and Lúthien. Oh God.
Hello. I think I hang up.
I don't know why it keeps saying my internet connection is unstable. Are you there?
Yeah, actually, the screen hung up for something.
Oh, okay. This is Middle Earth. And did you read all of the Tolkien books?
Yeah, actually I read it when I was in ninth class. It's almost, you can say, almost 20 years before or something. So they were available in library.
Are these novels or are these just boring history books?
No, actually these are the novels. These are the rewritten novels of the J.R.R. Tolkien's original stories. Those stories are of 15 volumes. Okay, these are the novels written by using the original story and turned into the exciting novel by other authors also. Okay, the original credit go to the J.R.R. Tolkien. Okay, the J.R.R. Tolkien written this in the era of World War II. Actually, World War I and II, in between that, actually.
Wait, so when was this written?
In between the era of World War I and II.
Between World War I and World War II. Interesting.
Yeah, exactly. And the major fact is that, the unknown fact is that all the stories are based on the Indian stories, actually. These are all Indian characters. Yeah, exactly. You see elves, we call them devtas. You see dwarves, we call them batus and everything. Everything shown is there is all Indian continent, just transformed in the German way. He actually got the hold of old German books, okay, from the era of when the kings and queens were there, and those German books come from the transformed from the Sanskrit books at the time almost 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. So that story goes from there actually.
It's very, very interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, some of these aren't even available yet.
Yeah.
How can it not be available yet? What the heck is it?
No.
Wait, it's not even
to like read and then the publisher publishes it. He says yes or something like that.
No, no, actually, what are they doing is that they are making it, making these novels in suitable for the movies, actually. The original story is very different. Okay, it's not actually suitable for the movie, and they are actually making the novels out of the stories to be suitable for to make the movies. So that's why they are not available yet. So once they write something, these writers write something out of that story, which will be suitable for any making new movie, then they release it. It's like that. It's a whole business of Hollywood, actually.
Absolutely. What's the name of the book that you're reading right now? Can we see it here on Amazon?
Yeah. It's available.
What's the name of it?
The Extinction Trials.
The Extinction
Trials.
Extinction Trial.
There is no C. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, that one. The cover is nice.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
After a mystery man, six strangers wake up in an underground bunker. They don't know how much time has passed or where the bunker is located.
Oh my god.
You know what this sounds just like the heck is the name of that the Maze Runner.
Oh yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Right? These strangers wake up in a bunker. They seem to be part of an experiment called the Extinction Trials. Exactly. And then
you know what
the good thing about it is? I'm sure it's a great novel. I'm sure it's different in its ways, but every story's already been done, you know. It's like, just change the character and then you can do Star Wars again. Call it Moon Wars.
Yeah, exactly. Most of these are survival actually stories. Either you get an apocalypse war or anything, something like that. And it's just a survival story after all.
Cool. The Extinction Trials. Awesome. That's like, oh, it looks interesting. It looks like a good book. I'd love to, I think in my, and you like it? Pete, you think it's a good book?
But you need to actually, you need what you can say, liking to the genre, actually. If you don't like it, it will be a waste of time.
I don't know. How can anyone not like this genre? This is very interesting. It's like any other, any big budget Hollywood film, right? So that's that one. Let me move this to a different one.
Oh god, the amount of tabs you have, it's insane.
Well, that's just one browser. I got a number of them. That's probably why my internet connection is not good, because I'm so here. Let's look at the other one. So this is what I'm reading now, this book, John. Okay, India.
Oh, yeah, same cover. Mm-hmm.
No, it's not the same cover. Isn't that weird? Yeah.
Oh, it's not? Maybe it's another edition. So just scroll down and you'll find it, I guess. You should find it.
Okay, this is super creepy. How can I possibly have a new version of the book that's not...
You know what I'm thinking? Editions.
I bought this at the airport in London, I think. So
last time you went there?
Yeah. So I'm thinking maybe this is just a version that was printed in England. Let me see, like in the UK.
Speaking of which, Queen Elizabeth is dead.
She died?
It's not funny. Yes, she died. Just a few minutes ago, an hour ago.
Yeah, I heard she wasn't doing well.
Yeah.
Now one of those princes is now the King of England?
Charles is gonna die soon too, I guess, but Prince William is gonna take over at some point.
That's interesting. Yeah, this is a British publisher, HarperCollins London Bridge Street, London.
We love colonizing.
Harper Collins, Dublin, Ireland. So I guess I got it. This version's not available on the American Amazon. So anyway, this is the book here. And it's a long
book. Of course you can find it. There's no way you can't find it because it's like...
No, I mean, it's the same book. It's just, this is just a different version. But the version that I have, when was it published? It was published in 2010.
Oh, so that's the...
So it's the same, maybe. Interesting. So yeah, here's the book.
What does it revise
with 40,000 new words? Oh my gosh. It's part of me.
It talks about the history of India.
Yeah, the whole thing is India. It's the history. Right now I'm at Nataraj, the rule of the dance, the year 950 to 1180. I'm hoping that what I'm realizing is I think that the Indian history is very murky. Definitely. In the past. They don't know a lot about. So I'm thinking that as it gets farther and farther along, maybe the book will take on more of a storytelling aspect. Because now it's... like it's a bunch of
Were living in their own world, honestly. It's really cool. They had their own community, they had their own thing.
India and China, those two places are just kind of
Africa, especially South Africa.
And Africa too, yeah. And Egypt. My gosh, Egypt.
Oh my, Egypt had many civilizations though.
Yeah. So that's that. I can't really give a really good.
Well, there is China. Buy the China book.
Oh, here's the China.
You love China books.
Huh. A history of China. An authoritative account of 5,000 years of. Maybe I'll, you know what? Where's the list? Where do you add it to like your list? Add to list. Here we go. Can I do that?
Yeah, you can.
General books. There we go. Cool. All right. I'll decide whether I buy it after I finish this, because if he continues to bore me for another 400 pages.
He probably will. It'll only get better at the end. Sorry, yeah, but most finally, of the books are like this.
The last four pages, and all of a sudden.
Yeah.
The end. Oh. So, what was the name, one of the books you're reading, Malak?
Maybe Take Winner's Dream or The Confidence Code, because I read more of this one. So The Confidence Code by Carrie Gann.
I already did Winner's Dream.
Oh.
Who is he? He looks familiar.
He is an owner of a software company, I think. I don't know. I got the book when he came to he had a speech here. And so he gave everyone a book and my father gave it to me. He was like, yeah, read it. I was like, yeah, cool.
Oh, he's the head of the call software company, SAP. Interesting. All right, let's hear what the city says. Growing up in working class Long Island, 16-year-old Bill worked at a deli, applied ideas, went to college, sold copiers for Xerox. He left Xerox, became the unlikely president of SAP's flailing American business unit. And he injected enthusiasm and he was named co-CEO in May 2014. He became SAP's sole and first non-European CEO. So it's a European country, a European company. What can you tell us so far about the book? Good so far?
Yeah, I read around 20 pages and it's, 300 pages. I started reading it yesterday and so far so good. It's very interesting. I like the way he tells stuff. The storytelling is nice.
All right, I'll add him to the list too. Good. Oh, I should add the other book that I looked at, the one that he recommended. So this is basically a book on how he went from corner store to corner office.
Yep.
Very cool. Okay.
Very interesting.
Very interesting. All right, I'll show another one of mine. Or Heath, do you have another book that you're working on that you're reading?
I read one book at one time.
Oh, he's one of those people. You know, Heath, I thought you were going to be a great member of BreakDiving.
Yeah. Don't Thank listen you. To him, Heath. You're the unique one.
But thank you, Alec.
Stop making me look bad, Mom.
I'm sorry. Everyone knows you're amazing. You got to leave some like spots for some other people.
I will consider myself amazing when BreakDiving has tens of thousands of members and is making massive amounts
of
money.
You already achieved a lot of things. You just look at one thing and you just want this one thing so badly that you forget everything that you've done, everything else like in the past. And that's wrong. You should celebrate the other stuff that you
What's
achieved.
What's so wrong about wanting a five-legged puppy?
But no, seriously, just focus on BreakDiving right now. At some point it'll become something, and then
it already is something.
Exactly. See, so you have something to celebrate after all, don't you, Monroe?
Did you hear what she just said?
I was trying to motivate him. He's trying to make me look as the bad guy.
You are. That's
manipulation, Monroe. I'm so sad now.
Not manipulation. It's calling a spade a spade.
Yeah, sure.
So this book, this guy, Ray Dalio, is basically not thought of as one of the best investors and entrepreneurs in the United States. And he also went from rags to riches, from what I understand.
Oh my God. They all went from like poor people to amazing people, from the worst human beings to the best human beings. At this point, we should know that we don't stand a chance, because they all seem to come from the lowest places on earth and then make it to the top as like the heroes, whatever.
Hey, speak for yourself. I'm a horrible human being. So there's only one place for me to go, and that is up. So yeah, look, it is these principles and not anything special about Dalio, who grew up as an ordinary kid in middle class.
It all starts with the same thing.
You know that other guy that wrote your book, Malak, the one that you're reading?
Yeah.
Guess where he grew up as an ordinary kid? Long Island.
Really? Same place.
Same place.
Oh, that's a sign. That's something.
I grew up in middle class, near Long Island, so maybe that counts. I don't know.
Maybe you're next.
Hey, Ray Dalio is the Steve Jobs of investing and the philosopher king of the financial universe. So he's doing two books called Principles. This is the first one, and this one is called...
Is it like a sequel?
No, this is the first book of two. First is the Principles for Life and Work.
Mm-hmm.
That he gained, and then the next book that he's working on now are the Principles for Investing in Financial Success.
Mm-hmm.
Did you
read the second one?
No, I'm reading the first one. The second one hasn't come out yet.
Oh.
I'm only on chapter one. All I've read so far is the introduction. So
that's what, two pages?
Yeah, so I'm going to read at least four more pages today. Probably I'll end up reading chapters one and two, so it'll be about 15 pages in that.
Is it fun?
Yeah, it's a very good book. See, I'll read the two quotes that are on the front here. One is from Bill Gates. Ray Dalio has provided me with invaluable guidance and insights that are now available to you. And Tony Robbins, I found it truly extraordinary. Every page is full of so many principles of distinction and insights. He incorporates his history and life in such an elegant way. So great.
Sounds interesting, honestly.
Yeah, it's a very good one. What was the other one, Malak, that you mentioned?
The Confidence Code.
That's funny. That sounds familiar. I don't know if I've read that.
It's amazing. I love it.
Yes, I have read this book.
You did? It's nice, yeah. Right?
I've read it about, oh wait, it was printed in 2018. Is there another confidence code? Let me see. Let me see if there's another book called that, because I definitely didn't read it in 2018. And so maybe, I don't know. I don't know. Doesn't sound familiar. Those authors don't sound familiar. But anyway, tell us about it.
But you have to read it if you're interested, because it's actually really nice. Honestly, all I can say is that it literally just talks about tips. And in order for them to explain a concept, they use like storytelling and then real life situations and stuff like that to catch your attention. And it's really good. Honestly, I love it. And they make it personal too. So it's, you know, you can relate to some of the stuff that they say.
I definitely didn't read this because look at the subtitle, What Women Should Know.
Yeah. It's mostly designed for women, but anyone can read it, honestly. It's really good.
I think it's kind of stupid that they make these books for men or for women, except for things
probably that- just to say that, oh, girl power, you know, just designed
it for women. I get why they didn't, and it's a marketing thing, but of course anything in there is applicable to a guy.
Exactly.
Like, I can understand if it was a book on menopause for women over 50.
But you know how like they have these books for like minorities, like anyone can read them, but they just mention the word minority to catch your attention of like, oh, you have to read it because you're from like this specific community, etc.
Yeah, it's identity politics. Silly stuff. And like again, certain things like buying rental property in Singapore. I understand that may be very targeted because the law is different.
Yeah.
In Singapore than it might be in, not that it might be.
But it's a good investment in Singapore.
If you have a book that specifically tells you this is the law in Singapore and the process that you need to go through, great. But yeah, the stuff about people's identities and stuff, I don't know. It's just.
The thing about these stuff are like so interesting to see from like different perspectives. But the thing is, let me tell you, I swear to God, I grew up, it's so weird. I'm telling you, I swear to God, it's so weird. It's because you go somewhere and you don't feel like you completely belong there, even though you're like okay with it and it's perfect. But there's this like weird feeling, even in your own country. That's what happens when you grow up in like different environments. Like you go to school, this is an environment. You are back at home, this is an environment. You travel to this country, it's an environment. It's insane, but it's really good. Like that's my favorite part of life, or at least my life. It's so nice to just.
I think it's why I love traveling so much. I like to be in other people's cultures.
It's so good. It's literally the best thing ever.
It's so weird because I'm an American and I always like to come back here, but I don't like living here.
Why you don't like doing it?
I just find that I feel people who, whenever I go to other countries, they often don't have, sometimes they don't have the resources to go to other countries, but they are so eager to travel and to learn about other people's cultures and histories. And I just find that Americans just don't care as much. They're not fascinated.
They know nothing.
They don't want to travel. They don't learn foreign languages. They don't understand history as much. And I'm saying, are there maybe the grass is always greener type of thing. And I just find other people's cultures different. And I love traveling because it's so new. And I am that type of person that loves novelty. And again, why it's maybe I read 3 or 4 pages of a book and then switch to another and then to another in these circuits. But I don't know. I'm always happier when I'm outside the country. I'm going to Bimini, Bahamas with my mom for a 3-day cruise type of thing in October. I bet those 3 days are just going to be liberating. And then when I get back to the US, it'll be like, oh, back to the grind, back to the USA.
But I mean, if you travel, I feel like you won't really hate it as much. You can like live here, but then travel and see other countries and then come back.
I think that's what I want to, what I have to do. I actually made I got my list. I came up with three cool things here. This is actually something for anyone who's watching.
That's a nice list. It looks good.
Thank you.
I like how it looks.
I realize what stressed me out when you've got 1.5 million things that you're doing is you get overwhelmed with all of the things. And I was talking to my students at EF yesterday, talking about when you have expenses and you're building up your emergency fund, you have to separate your obligatory monthly expenses from your discretionary. Because if you lose your job, you don't need to go out to the movies. Mm. You just need to pay your rent, pay for your car payment, pay your taxes, buy food. That's what you need to make sure that you can survive the drought. And I realize that's the same thing with when you've got lots of tasks and lots of projects. You have to discern what are your obligatory tasks, your strongly important, and when you have free time. My problem was I was putting all of these on the one daily list and I was never getting it all done. And it was just driving me crazy because when I don't finish things, it gets me antsy and I want to see progress. So I made this actually just last night where these are my obligatory daily tasks. I have to do these every single day. And only when I am done with all of these can I move on to my strongly important tasks. And then when I have free time tasks. And it was a very helpful exercise to break up the things that I'm doing into these three different categories. And so anyway, that was just a random side note. Hichandra, what are you? Oh, I was going to say, imagine if I came out with a book called The White Man's Guide to Finance.
Okay, that's going too far. Honestly, write something about being white somewhere else. But the thing is, you've only been to white countries. You gotta spice it up a little bit. Go see another world. And
I've only been to white countries?
I mean, mostly. Europe, yay.
You know anything about Malaysia?
You went to China. Okay. You went to Iraq. You went to... Where else?
So first of all, the fact that I lived for a year in Iraq and I lived a year in China totally negates your, you've only been to white
countries. That's an expression, okay? I didn't mean like zero, but like
I've been to South Africa, I've been to Swaziland.
You've been to South Africa? How was it? I want to go to South Africa.
It was lovely. I loved it. I want to go back there. I've been to Kuwait.
No way. You didn't tell me that. You never mentioned it to me.
I've been to Turkey.
I've been to Bulgaria.
I've been to Russia, Mongolia, China, Japan, South Korea. And
now I'm mad that I didn't know that. What?
I haven't even finished my list yet. I could go
on. Okay, go on. I want to know. Okay, keep going.
Pretty much every country in Europe. I've been to Mexico. I've been to Brazil. I've been to, let me see, where else have I been? To Canada.
That's really nice.
And God, there are lots of other places.
See, you saw the world.
Yeah,
I've
seen a lot of it. Yeah.
I've seen a lot, but I think I still have a long way to go.
So wait, but you're saying that the white man's guide to fitness is not. The white male's guide to success in business.
You're getting us canceled on social media, I swear to God.
Well, here's the thing. The point of break diving is to show how absurd we are one people in the world.
Yes. I really hope people understand that. I don't know why they need to like make up groups and communities and God knows what else. It literally is annoying at some point. It's nice annoying. To see the differences, it's
racist and causes more division. There is, and a breakdiving, none of us care that all three of us, the three of us have different skin colors, even though he doesn't put on camera. So I'm just going based on his
and different backgrounds too, which is really nice.
And I think if people just focused on we're human beings and we all have different circumstances, how do we change our circumstances rather than I'm black or I'm white or I'm Indian or I'm a woman. It's like, just shut up. You can't do anything about it. Get over it. Go to school, start a business, become wealthy, whatever. So
but focus about this a lot.
That will be the interior of the white man's guide to business. Shut the f up Go start your damn business.
Especially in America, by the way. I hear this a lot there. It's insane. Whenever they say something, they need to mention the ethnicity first.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't know why.
Look at all of our members from India and Nigeria, where we have a lot of members.
Yeah.
Do you see how enthusiastic they are? And they're enthusiastic. They are not jaded. They're enthusiastic about succeeding. They're excited when other people are successful. And I think there's a conversation that we have. There's a difference between Black Africans and Black Americans.
Yeah, because
not as a blanket statement, but a good majority of Black Africans they don't feel like they are at a disadvantage because of their race.
It's because they live in a community that's mostly like them in some way, which is not the case, for example, like African Americans in America. So I guess.
But I think it's so funny though, because Black Americans have, quote unquote, a greater likelihood of success.
Because they are in a more developed.
Because they're in America, and yet the people in Nigeria, in Zimbabwe, and our members here on BreakDiving show that. They have a greater feeling that they can succeed.
And
than
it's
the Black Americans
way better to succeed in Africa than in America. I'll give you that.
What's that?
It's better. It's not better in a way, but not easier either. But you have many ways to succeed in Africa, which is not the case in America. Like, they have more chances in some way if you have what it takes.
You know why they have more chances? Because they believe they do.
Exactly.
Whether it's true or not.
And because they think about making their life better. It's because they see other people around them from different, let's say, social backgrounds. And that motivates them to do something new and to help each other. And they're really close to each other. It's insane. You go there and everyone knows each other. Everyone's kind to each other. And I think that is key to their success, honestly.
We were talking that in the chat room earlier with Heat and Malak, the three of us, about the fact that the sense of close-knit community, helping one another in Africa, in India, in China, in Middle East, is far greater than the United States. And in the United States, that's both its blessing and its curse.
True, I agree with that one.
Because everyone is out for themselves here. You can do anything you want. You can trample on people along the way if you want to. And people just expect it. Whereas in Europe, actually not sorry, maybe Europe somewhere, but in Saudi Arabia, in Middle East, in Africa, in India, as you guys were saying, people are more likely to be cooperatively helpful. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Yeah, instinctively, actually.
What's that, Heath?
Instinctively.
Instinctively. And again, that comes back to the upbringing and the culture.
Yes. My dad told me when I was 12, he said something to me and I will never forget it. He was like, Malak, governments can solve everything in society. They can just, you know, help out in a way. What really makes a country developed enough to like do great things is the population. Because once people are there for each other, things get 10 times better.
Yeah.
And we live it every day. And it's like, it's so nice. We don't realize it's not the same everywhere else. So I'm thankful for that. But it's also nice to go and, you know, experience other ways of life and lifestyles and stuff like that. So that's definitely interesting. You need to come to Saudi, though.
My mom says that you guys are friends now.
Yes, she's really cool. I talked to her. I like texted her just yesterday. She's really nice and fun.
Maybe she and I can come and visit you. And maybe we can try to work together to put together a Saudi breakdiving event.
Come over here. You'll love it.
Beautiful. So the last thing.
Join him. Don't stay in India. Go see the world.
Yeah,
and go back.
Do you have a passport?
No, I don't. Obviously. Actually,
what?
I don't want to go out of my country.
Just go visit and then come back. it's nice to see the rest of the world.
Can I tell you this? You need to have a passport if for only one reason. If you suddenly need, for some reason, to leave your country because the situation gets bad,
you need to
be able to get out quickly. And if the situation gets bad, everyone's going to be processing, trying to get a passport. I always say that to my mom, like both and I, the U.S., quote unquote, greatest country in the world, so much success. But you know what? My mom and I are always talking about what happens if this country collapses. Where are we going?
Speaking of
actually, one thing I will tell you, if that happens, majority of Indians will not process for passport and go outside. They will die here, and it happens several times in our country. Actually, the thing is that whatever happens, we never leave India. And whoever gone out of the India, they also come back to India after their working and everything. They actually come here. It's very long, a very strong bond from ancient time. Actually, it's not about anything. I mean, it's no situation thing, no poverty or prosperity or anything. We have been through almost every kind of thing, prosperity, poverty, power, and everything. But we never leave our country, actually.
It's about patriotism and actually feeling like you belong there.
Not patriotism, but patriotism comes second. But one thing is that we consider our country as a mother, actually. That's the thing. And it's in our genes that we consider our country as a mother.
Mother.
It's mother.
Like mom.
Mom. Yeah, exactly.
So in a good way. I mean, I remember like the USSR, they used to call it Mother Russia.
But not they actually hate it.
What did you think of that? That's really good.
Because it's the only time I've ever heard somebody think of their country as a mother.
That's a very known expression. They use it to say, like, to express their love to their country and stuff.
Most of the country took that expression from India because they see that how powerful it becomes, actually. So Russia took it, Ukraine actually took it. And whoever you see the patriotism in very high, they took that idea from the India. Actually, considering
you don't ever want to leave, not even for tourism anywhere.
No, we go for tourism from the ancient times, but we always come back to our country. We come back to our country.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Leave and then come back, you know, just like visit other countries.
So, no, the Mundo was saying that if the situation becomes very unstable in the country, or suppose
it doesn't mean you have to leave forever.
No. If suppose there is a famine in here, okay, in India for 100 years, okay, suppose that, okay, for 100 years, the whole India is having a famine, okay. It happened in the past, actually. So suppose everyone is dying, okay, and somebody is to leave the country. They will not, actually. They will die here. They won't leave the country.
Okay. Yeah, we don't betray our country. We stay there, and yeah.
Yeah, but I agree with you. There are certain people in India that believe that, but I mean, a number of our volunteers here at BreakDiving, even a lot of our members, they don't live in India anymore. They all move.
Many of them find everything everywhere.
To Europe, to Asia.
Yeah, but they actually, if they have been brought up out of the country, okay, they born and brought up out of the country, they don't feel that way. But who have born and brought up here, okay, and just go for work outside, they get settled there for the time being in the foreign, but they come back here, actually. That's the actual fact.
That's very common with Africans and Asians and Middle Easterns.
Exactly, yes. Yeah. Those who are of ancient actually kingdoms or ancient cultures, they come back to their actually homeland afterwards. That's the, and it is more majorly seen in the India, actually. Mm.
Very interesting. Mm. So the last book that we're going to discuss today is the other book I'm reading. NOLO it stands for No Lawyer. I mean, and they're these awesome books, and they're very thick. I mean, look, it's a lot of book. And anytime, even though I'm a lawyer, I don't know everything. Anytime I want to learn how to do something better from a legal standpoint, I'll just go look for a book by NOLO. They've got hundreds of books on everything. And a lot of it applies. Say it again.
So you're telling me all of this is to talk about choosing the right people?
Yeah, this whole book.
Oh my God.
Because look, you guys both know the hell that I went through recently.
Yeah. No.
I will never make that mistake again. And
I need everything in this book. You definitely need it.
What I've learned from this book, when I read how specific it is in terms of your investigation of potential tenants, it's the same. There's an expression when you're hiring, when you're working as a business owner, hire slow and fire fast. Mm. Meaning take your time before you bring somebody on board the company, because once they do, if you choose the wrong person, it could screw up everything. And as soon as you realize somebody's not a good fit, fire that person, get that person out of there. Don't keep giving second, third, fourth chances because you're just wasting your time and whatnot. And I realized that's the same thing that applies to everything in life. Hiring, getting tenants, rent slow, evict fast, a spouse, marry slow, divorce fast.
Marry slow.
And no one wants to encourage divorce, but how many times do you see people who stay in a relationship with a person who makes that person's life miserable,
beats
the wife or the husband, treats the kids poorly, doesn't provide for the family? And it's like, why are you giving these persons so many chances if the person does not improve your life?
Mm-hmm.
I believe God will forgive you for...
because apparently it's forbidden in Christianity, right?
Yeah, you can't. What about in Islam?
No, you can get a divorce.
Oh, and it's encouraged. No,
not encouraged. But if you ever need a divorce, you can have it.
Yeah, that's an interesting discussion for another time. Is why would Christianity say it's not encouraged, whereas Islam say that it's not discouraged?
The thing about the three religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, is that they have the same base, but then they have different rules, I'm gonna say. We share things in common between Judaism and then Islam, and then some things between Christianity and Islam, but we're not really the same anyway, because we come from the same, it's like the same source, but then everything changes with time. And the only religion that hasn't been changed until now from the three is Islam. So it's like nice to like see that we have some similarities and then differences, obviously.
Are you Hindu or something different?
Oh, I'm Hindu. Actually, we are lives in the South Asia, after the Himalayas. They are called Hindus, actually. They are one race.
Consider Hinduism as an ethnicity, right? Just like Judaism.
No, it's forbidden. Hindu is an actual geographical identity.
It's also considered an ethnicity.
Yeah, it's made of two words. He is made of Hindu Kush. Okay, it's a name of the Himalayas. Okay, Hindu Kush. And Hindu is a Sindhu, the sea of Indian Sea, you can say. So whoever lives in between these two actually landmarks, they are called Hindus, actually.
So what's the difference?
The difference is that it's a one race. Actually, it's an ancient race. It's called the Hindus, actually. There is a lot of history. I don't know if many of you have read the things, but that actually Hindus were existed even before Egyptians, Sumerians, and long before that. Actually, yeah. The thing is that Sumerians, Egyptians, these are all just recent happenings. They are just like modern things, actually, as considered the Hindus.
Yeah.
So what are you then? Are you considered a Hindu race?
Everybody is considered Hindu in India.
Everyone
is considered themselves Hindu. Even Muslim considered themselves.
It's basically considered as a race, Monroe. So you know how you're like, you're white or you're Arab or you're like Jewish and then you're Hindu.
Well, Jewish is that's a whole other story. Is Jewish just a religion?
Exactly. That's the thing. That's the same thing with the Hindu like nation. They can be Hindu as an ethnicity, and then they don't specifically follow the religion of the Hindus, and then they can be both religiously and then ethnically Hindus. And the same thing with Judaism. You can be ethnically Jewish and follow Christianity, for example, and you can be ethnically Jewish and follow Judaism, and then you can be non-Jewish ethnically and follow Judaism. You know, it's like tribe kind of thing.
That's very interesting.
You're lost.
No, I'm just thinking about it. Yeah, there's a lot of permutations to how that could work.
Yeah.
And, well, this was a great book club event. I got some good ideas for some new books, and you know what? I realized we should do this more often because it's interesting. Because it look at the interesting discussion.
Definitely.
Just by getting different books, and before you know it, it just results in lots of different jumping off conversations and all that jazz. Any final words, Heat or Malak?
No, just have a good day.
So it was really good to meet Malak, actually. Yeah. It's first time actually I'm hearing. Yeah.
This is the first time?
Yes, yeah, we exactly. Talked for like a month or so, and then that's the first time we ever meet.
Good.
Yeah.
Maybe one day Heat will get a camera. we will see if he really is Hindu.
Oh,
he definitely is. He is pure Indian.
So to those of you watching on the internet, I hope you'll click like, subscribe, hope you share a comment, share this video with your friends. If you want to be a part of this discussion, if you think something we said was not correct, well then come join BreakDiving and join in on the discussion. And you can find the link in the description. And we hope you have a wonderful day. Remember our motto, no rules, no excuses, no regrets. And what is BreakDiving? Don't wait for opportunities to float to the surface. You need to dive in and make your own breaks in life. I'm Monroe Man. This is Malak Masaba, Hichandra, and I don't know what, Hichandra, what is your last name? Or do you not have one because you're like Madonna?
I have a last name. My last name is Tikale.
Say it again.
Tikale.
Tikale.
Yeah, exactly.
Tikale. Hichandra Tikale.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Don't leave. I'm just going to stop the recording.
Yeah.